at 222 for Jake Telford.
Go to Jessie Telford. She comes from Caldwell, Idaho.
And I've been joking around with him, calling him Jessie Telford's husband, because now she's, you know, she made the NFR last year, and we're so proud of her. So, I mean, she won over 100 grand there last year at the NFR. I mean, this is a super competitive family.
This is still a really small public school, and it's actually not in our, that's why I have to drive them. There's no bus or anything, which Jake and I, we have been on the fence so many times back and forth whether we should homeschool with as much as we travel. When they get in high school, if they get to the point where they want to go, be able to go to more rodeos or go to more horse shows, you know, we'll probably give it that choice to them whether they want to homeschool or continue.
Can't forget the rope horse. Oh, there's probably, I'm gonna say, close to 50 horses on this place with all of our kids' horses and everything that's here. But generally we keep, 25 to 30 outside horses, just depending on the time of year. Right now, there's probably closer to 30 here because of all the two-year-olds that are here getting started. And then as we weed through some of those, send some of those home, it might get down to 20 or 25 during the show season. A couple years ago, there was a piece of property that came for sale over behind us there. It's a 60, and so Jesse and I kind of scraped together and bought it. It's just a hay field, but it's pretty nice. We've been able to raise all our own hay to feed, and so the training business kind of pays the farm for the hay, and instead of paying someone else, and then in turn that pays the payment on that piece of property. So it's worked out pretty good to raise our own hay for the training business.
This whole lifestyle, I think, benefits a family and benefits kids. Goes back to how I was raised. You know, when you're raised on a ranch, your parents are always at home. You know, you don't just see them just in the evenings. Our kids, I mean, I remember growing up and seeing physically how hard both of my parents worked all day, every day. And it just came natural to me to want to work, physically work that, you know, that hard for something that you love. You know, our kids, they're fortunate enough, they get to see Jake and I work every day. They come home from school, and you know, the first thing, they come in the house, they grab a snack. We don't have to tell them to come to the barn or you know, you guys, it's grab a snack as quick as they can. They close or change their clothes, and they're outside with us, you know. And it's not all work for them. I mean, they're 12 and 13, but they're definitely outside every day, whether, you know, and that's, we get a lot of winter here, so whether it's snowing or it's 100 degrees out, they'll go find something to do, even if it's filling two-year-old waters when it's 100 degrees out. They'll manage to get soaked doing it, but they know, they, to me, appreciate work, and, you know, for their age, I without a doubt know they have more work ethic than a lot of kids out there their age. They're 12 and 13, they're almost exactly a year apart, so all growing up, everything that one did the next, you know, they did together. It wasn't like Shawnee got to do this because she was older and then Sierra could finally, you know, pretty much from the get-go, they've done everything together. They both are now to the age where we can, you know, we can put them on a three-year-old without a doubt and not worry. You know, they know when one's getting fresh or getting ready to buck, and they know how to pull a head around. And you know, I'm sure there's going to be times they do get bucked off. You know, it's going to happen. But I'm not scared about it anymore. They're both big enough, strong enough, and they, like I said, they can feel a horse well enough to know what's happening.
Well, we are ready. Ladies and gentlemen, are you all ready to have some fun on the World's Greatest Horseman Night?
Best of the best, so to speak, is the World's Greatest Horseman. Those are the horses that have had the most training, are the best at their job. Event of ones, it's one rider and one horse and one bridle, and so to have one that's trained enough to do those multiple disciplines, you know, it's hard to find those horses that are capable, let alone doing it at that level. You know, it's a tough competition.
So there's, in the World's Greatest Horseman, there's no really age limit. You're going to see some horses in there on Saturday that are probably 6-7 years old, and then there's some that are going to have some age on them, you know, that there's no age limit to it. They're just bridle horses. But it usually, generally, it takes, in our training process, it takes 6 to 7 years to get a horse in the bridle and able to do those events at that level. And so it's a long process.
The crowd here at the World's Greatest, it's insane. I think they've been sold out for a few weeks at least, if not longer. I've got all kinds of my rodeo friends that are around right now, and they're all, you know, texting and calling and give me some tickets. So there's definitely more of a interest from the rodeo world in this event. And I do think it probably comes from the added event of the steer stopping that draws more in. We all appreciate horse industry when you can see the best of the best, like whether it's jumping, barrel racing, showing horses, whatever. And really, to me, the World's Greatest Horseman, it is the best of the best of the older horses. You know, they're the most seasoned, most trained.
Watch this, Palomino!
Yeah!
We'll probably put some practice, the ones you had on this morning, put those on, and then I have a show bag packed with some clean white ones for you to show in.
His mom came over and stayed with our girls for one night before, because Jake had to leave to come down here. I had to leave 2 days before he did to get down to San Antonio for my first set. And so then my parents, they drove over. They live about 5 hours away. They drove over and stayed with the girls for the last 3 days. And then they all flew down yesterday here to Fort Worth. Yeah. And I've been in San Antonio this whole time. I've had 5 runs there already. And I ended up making the short round, which is Saturday night. So I got done running last night. And then I left this morning from down there at about 5 a.m. and got here. He had some cattle pens spotted for me, threw some shavings in them for me. So when I got here, I could just unload. I needed a shower. So the wet hair, the baseball cap, all of that, I was in the trailer showering, and I get the text from him. She's gonna show in 20 minutes. So I take off at a trot over there, and our daughter went and showed. Both of our girls were entered. But anyways, Shawnee, our oldest one, her horse, he just was, he got sore when he got down here. So she didn't get to show, but our youngest daughter did. And she did really good for her first time down here.
The Western lifestyle is a good way to bring up kids. It's, there's not the computers and the drugs and the, you know, some bad things that they're exposed to. Have they not have so much parent involvement, I guess. They come home from school and we're always here. They come outside and they're with us. But exposing them to accomplishing something, having a way of life that's fulfilling and good at the same time, I guess, it's hard for me to put that into words, but hopefully they find their own passion and then they know the amount of work and effort and try that goes into achieving your goals. So whatever their goals become, I hopefully I've taught them how to get there if they want it. Okay, so this is a 2-year-old filly. She's by Goodbye Lane and out of Hot Donna, the full sister to Cool Whip there. She's probably got 2 months of riding on her. give or take a little. We own her, and so ours have a tendency to get skipped a lot, but she's been a really good-minded, quiet, easy filly to start, a lot like her mother. I'll just kind of move her around a little bit and show you what I've been working on. At this stage in the game, I don't get too critical of anything they do. I'm just trying to get the basics on them. Walk, trot, lope, circles, stop, back up, so that they have a good foundation for Jessie to work with when she goes to putting them on the pattern. You know, basic things is just being able to follow that nose around. You know, I don't do a whole bunch to these babies. I just try to let them find their way and try to make sure that their feet follows their nose. I can pull their nose where I want it to be, whether it be all the way around. And I try to make their feet follow where their nose went. That's kind of the basic foundation. I feel like it doesn't matter whether it's my cow horses or Jessie's barrel horses or rope horses or English horses, it doesn't matter. That's kind of your basic foundation, is be able to get control of that head and neck, then control of those shoulders, and lastly, control of those hips back there, so that you can put a horse in any position that you want for the event that you're doing.
I think a lot of times girls that are not used to riding two-year-olds as much, when they first start trotting and loping them with that one inside rein and they start falling to the inside of the circle, they just want to keep pulling harder, but you know, trying to lift that up. And it's important. That's when you just switch directions. You just change directions and it makes their shoulders stand, makes everything stand up. That at this stage, they're not ready to only be lifted with that inside rein. It just makes them fall in harder.
Yeah, it's these babies, it's a lot of just little things. I try to do a little bit a lot of times, you know. I don't try to force something on them all in one or two rides. We ride them pretty consistently, with the exception of our own, I guess. But so we just try to do a little bit each day and try to keep those basics simple so that they figure things out. I want them, at this stage in the game, it's more important to me to have a happy colt that tries to figure out what I'm asking it to do than it is to have it doing a whole bunch of things. You know, there's guys that can, in 60 days, have them, you know, going through an obstacle course and stopping and spinning. But down the road, those horses have a tendency to lose their try. And at this stage in the game, I really focus on just having a happy little camper. I mean, you can see she's pretty willing to go wherever I want to go. She's relaxed. You know, I work on the little things like putting her in a bind, like right here. I'll pull on her pretty hard and just see if she'll think about, I want to engage her brain and have her think about where that release point is, where I want her to go to find her way out of those things. And it's little small drills like that where she's kind of in a bind, doesn't understand. Right there, I found a place where she wanted to go, and those little things will engage their brain and have them be thinking and trying and more of a willing participant, I think. It's been my experience. I've won a lot more on horses that try for you 100% rather than one that's a superior athlete but maybe only gives you 50%. So at this stage, I'm just doing a lot of little things. Like right here, she doesn't know that I want her to turn right here. I'm just going to get her in this bind and be patient and wait for her to find that. Think about how she can get her way out of that. She finds it to just release. It's just little exercises and drills that lay that foundation for future work.
I care more what they travel like and how they move, probably more so than even Jake's event, which I know is a show event. But I've watched him win on horses that move 10 different ways, you know, 10 different styles. And in the barrel racing, they have to travel with their hind end way up underneath them. I like them flat kneed, you know, it's hard to win on one that's high kneed. I don't think that they can run. So I don't know, when I'm looking at colts to, you know, whether we're looking at our own of what needs sold or looking at stuff to buy, And like this filly, I mean, besides sentimental, I love the way she moves.
I think it's true. When you're against the clock, the way they move, like she said, has a lot to do with how fast they are. You can't cover up the clock. It doesn't lie. Whereas I can do a lot of training and maybe cover up one that maybe possibly doesn't lope as slow as good, but can really stop and turn around. I have other areas to show off where she doesn't. At this stage, I'm trying to instill in them their ability to think and to try for me, because I've won a lot more on horses that give me 100%, that try their heart out for me. I would much rather have one that tries for me than one that's an exceptional athlete that only gives me half of what they can do. I think it's really important in any event you're doing.
100% agree. You have to have them confident, not just broke. I mean, you gotta have both. And you know, there's a lot of guys out there that can get a horse super broke and listening to you. But there's a big old difference between that and broke and confident. And so secure with the rider that's on them that they're not scared. They know that they're gonna go out there and you can feel it on a barrel horse that's finished. I mean, the confidence level coming in the arena, that they know. And you feel that same confidence coming back from them versus one that's going in there kind of unsure and almost listening to you too much. So that confidence is huge in a barrel horse, in any event, but really in a barrel horse, because there's so much that you just turn your reins loose and say, go get it done. There's a huge in between that colt and whip. And that's, to me, where the foundation and getting them broke is so important, is when you start adding all that speed to them, you know, when they start dropping in or they start trying to overthink, if you don't have a foundation where you can, you know, you can get a hold of them and you can pick a shoulder up or push a hip in or what you need to do, that's when you see those, to me, that the barrel horses that fall apart, that start out phenomenal and then they just end up falling apart because there's no tools to help you once you add all that speed, where you're going to have speed bumps. When people see me ride whip now, they probably don't think he looks super broke, but there's also that point of they earn the right to kind of act like a dill hole if they want to. And I know if I ever needed to get into him for something that I have all my tools there to do it. I don't now. And you know, when I see fraternity horses or that age horses and girls, to me, allowing them to act like a seasoned rodeo horse, I think it's gonna bite them in the butt later. You know, they need to be very respectful and know right from wrong, right from wrong, right from wrong for a few years through that speed, you know, building process.
We've branded calves on him and she turns back on him and he can be broke. She just, there's kind of that relationship between the two of them where she lets him get away with a little bit because he's kind of spoiled, but he's earned the right,
I guess. When people ask to me the common question, well, what do you do when you get home? You know, it's so boring to say I just ride horses, because that is so not what we, you know, my days are different every day. We have quite a few rental properties that I manage. I flip houses at least one a year. The kids have been to all those flips with me. I mean, they love demo day. They love knocking walls out. And, you know, anything different to me that you can, I love making money. I love, finding different creative ways to make money. Almost like a puzzle, whether it's buying the right prospect, you know, researching its pedigree, what else it's done, the way it moves, you know, all these things increase your chances of a profit or of having a success. My grandpa Gene, he started fighting bulls when he was a teenager in Bakersfield, California. And then his brother Bobby moved out to California a few years later. They actually started getting some rodeos and started there, and they went on for I want to say they fought bulls for about 30 years in the PRCA. They were the, you know, fought bulls at the very first NFR. Before that, they were at Madison Square Gardens, everywhere from Calgary to, they went, you know, Fort Worth, all of the big shows. They, at some point throughout their career, they were at those rodeos. So hearing my dad's stories also, growing up with chimps, you know, every morning at breakfast, there was at least one or two chimps at breakfast at the breakfast table with them. I don't know. They lived on the road a lot, obviously, very close family. I do believe traveling together, there's a different type of family camaraderie that happens when you travel and spend that much time in close quarters together. First 4 years after having my kids, I didn't hardly run barrels at all. Had some, you know, younger horses here that I would kind of get started or sell as prospects. But also at that time, man, we were building Jake's business. He was really starting to take off as far as his success in the show ring. All started about the same time that, you know, he was still a limited open trainer when Shawnee was born. And within 3 years, he was an open trainer. He was in, you know, I think 4 years. When Shawnee was four, he was the all-time leading money earner that year. And he continued that, you know, for the next 3 years. So his business was really taking off. I went to every show with him. I rode a lot of two-year-olds back then. You know, I think I focused more on our family and making sure that his business was as successful as possible. We never missed a horse show, not one day of a horse show back then. And something just kind of started eating at me that I felt like I wanted to go back to where I used to be a little bit, as far as I loved rodeo, and I don't think I'd been to a rodeo in 5 or 6 years. Like, as far as Jake's reaction when I said, hey, I wanna start competing again, I don't think he took it that serious, because I don't think in his eyes he ever really realized that I wasn't competing. You know, he was very also goal-driven and very focused on his business, that I don't think it really set in, that all of a sudden he realized I hadn't competed in a very long time.
Last year, she decided to go down south and go to a couple rodeos while I was down there also for our NRCHA World Show and World's Greatest Horseman. And those went pretty well. She did good. And we always knew he was fast enough, but you don't know how they handle the rodeo situation, whether they're going to do it or not do it. And he did it. And so I said, hey, I think she was itching to go too, but I encouraged her to enter some of those California rodeos, and she did really well. And so at that point, you know, it's what she loves to do, and how can you not be supportive? I mean, she's winning and doing good, and she loves it. And so I was behind her 100%, and I just told her she needed to keep going. I'm like, do you really have a decent horse and a good shot? And you might as well try it. It's not every day that those type of horses come along that are capable, and so while they're around, you better take advantage of it. You know, they're fragile animals, and so anything can happen. You might as well try him while you got him. And so fortunately, it's been really a good thing, and it hasn't always been easy. You know, it's a sacrifice sometimes, but it's been well worth it so far.
So one of the most important things in Jake's business is the horses have to always look good. Besides winning and all of that, you can go to a horse show and not win, but your owners are still happy if their horses look happy, healthy, and look pretty. You know, if you go you don't take the pride in making your horses look the best as possible, it's a reflection on your business. So one of the biggest things is big manes and tails. I learned this when I met Jake, and however many years, 15 years ago, It's crazy how well these knots, it makes their tails grow. It keeps them from falling out. Even when you see chunks like this, you'll still be impressed at how much tail grows and stays. So these knots have been in for probably at least 3 months, if not longer. And so I'm gonna pull them out and show you kind of what you have underneath, and then you wash it and put them back in. They're just simple figure eight knots. If you don't figure eight it, they will get tighter than holy smokes. It protects the hair, yet the horse still has like full function of a tail. I think everybody's seen a braid that's been in for a week in the middle of summer and it looks like a giant witch knot on a bronc horse. This doesn't ever get in witch knots. Even though it looks nasty, you know, up in here, it comes out so easy with a little shampoo and conditioner. And like I said, this right here is months that these have been in. In the winter here, it gets too cold. You can't give, you know, full baths as often as you want. So I'm not really, you know, everybody wants to know how it makes it grow, and I don't know. I don't know if it's the weight, the excess weight from the knot and the vet wrap, or if it's just the fact that they don't break it off nearly as much from just use. But I do know it works. So that's why I'm like, I don't know why, but it works. So I couldn't find my scissors. There's always a scalpel in there in the vet box. I went to, like, usually right about the hind ankles for Jake's, or a little higher for his. I probably actually will go a little bit higher because this colt's just gonna go back up in knots, so they're gonna just continue to grow and get thicker. My horses, I'd do it a little bit longer. So we brushed his tail all out. It's all dry. You will need a brush, scissors, and vet wrap. And I like these little things because I think it makes it go easier. So like some of the little short hairs that aren't gonna fit, I just grab those and pull them up and out of the way. And it kind of covers, because I'll take horses to jackpots and stuff with the knots in the tails. So if you do this part where you kind of get the little top stuff out of the way, when you are done with your knots, you let that down and it actually covers a lot of the knots so you can't even see them as much. So the key is to get it as close to the bone as possible. That way you have less chance of them ever like hooking it on a bucket or the fence or anything like that above the knot. So just twist, and then you have to do a full figure eight. Oh. So you'll like double that around to where it goes all the way around yourself one time. And then pull it back through, pull it tight, a little bit of vet wrap. But it honestly doesn't matter. 4 or 5 knots, and some do it with 10, you know. Yeah, it still works. I think too small of pieces is just a waste of time. These will lay flat, like right against the bone within a day. Like right now, they're still all kind of tweaked out just because we just did them. But when you let those top hairs down that I had pulled up, it almost completely covers all your knots. So if you go somewhere, like I don't feel like it just looks absolutely stupid. Always been an animal lover. Like it didn't matter if it was a horny toad I caught out on the desert, it was stuffed in my pocket and coming home. Any little bunny, whether cottontail, jackrabbit, whatever, if I could get off my horse fast enough and get it cornered, I would catch it and bring it home. My brother and I, you know, we'd spend hours out roping rock chucks, and there we had a few big old rock chucks that we had caged up, and we were gonna train them, and they're like a giant gopher. They're like, I mean, they'll get this big around and that fat, and they have some big old gnarly teeth, but we'd have like welding gloves on. And I don't know, it's been that way. And I'm sure my parents thought it would just be something I always outgrew, but you know, we had a pet coyote a few months ago, it's been probably 2 years ago now.
Yodi, sit. Good boy.
Good boy, Yodi.
Good job.
Oh, you think of morning, Shawnee.
Ow, my arm.
Oh, he loves his little Shawnee.
My kids, they're the same way. We've had jackrabbits, turtles, you know, anything we can catch, they seem to come home.
We picked up a lot of hawks that been like hit on the road. And then my mom actually about ran over a turtle when she was down kind of like near west side of Texas. And so she like backed up and pulled over. We still have it. It's our good luck turtle because my mom did really, I got a really good week after she picked it up.
It's like growing up, we've had a raised, you know, runt pigs to birds to, I mean, growing up on the farm, there was constantly a nest of pheasants that the mother got hit, and we'd catch the little babies and raise them and turn them loose. And
I knew whatever I was gonna do growing up to make a living, it somehow would have to have animals involved in it. That or I was gonna have a really part-time job and a really big-time hobby, one or the other. So I'm just extremely fortunate that I am able to make a living, and my husband and I both make a living, you know, with horses. And it's, when you have that much compassion for animals, I think it is so much easier to make a living at it, because you know, we don't get rich by doing it by any means. And there are a lot of hours spent outside at the barn, you know, extremely long days. It's 7 days a week. But when it's something you love, it's so much easier.
Holy smokes. The last two rodeos I've been to, I drove basically straight home from Kissimmee. I was home for a day, you know, which is 5 hours-ish from my house, to get all the way over there for slack, and I wasn't a fan of the ground at all. I felt it was dangerous for my horse's style. I guess I'm not gonna like go any further than that, but I drove that far, I was ready, and I just was in the alley and I told the judge that I was turning out. Like, I didn't feel safe running my horse there, so there's a, you know, 10-hour drive, round trip, away from the kids, all of that stuff, again, to not even get to compete. And then home for a week, and then this weekend, my kids had two junior rodeos, Saturday and Sunday. I ended up getting up Saturday night, last night, in Logandale, which is 11 hours from my house. So, man, I was on the fence, do I turn out so I can stay home for the rodeo with the kids? And, you know, this is a big circuit rodeo for us. My horse did really good in Logandale last year. So, kind of back and forth on the fence. Talked to everybody at home, and you know, my kids and Jake, they're both super big supporters of me going, and so I decided to leave. I kind of, you know, come down here, and my horse slips really bad on the first, you know, sticks his whole nose in the ground, all of that, and I end up just pulling up and walking out of the arena. So you know, a no time, 22 hours of driving, missed both my kids' rodeos. It's not always what it's cracked up to be. I just felt like, you know, it's so easy to always have the positive highlight reel out there, but there's definitely this side of it too. You know, a lot of driving, two no times now. The last two runs, you know, one was a turnout while I'm standing there. And, like I said, I just you know, missing kid events is hard. Anyways, that's where we're at. The kids are going to go with me to Red Bluff next weekend. So, at least that'll be better. And hopefully Red Bluff goes a lot better than the last two.
Bet some money on Jessie Telford. Caldwell, Idaho. She's been running good. She's been having a good year. She hasn't won, but she's been chipping away at them all year long.
This
Watch
lady went into Las Vegas in the number 15 spot. Ended up fourth in the world.
This is a four-generation strong cowgirl right here. Come on, yeah. Jessie. Go, go, go.
17-27. He just went to the lead in the aggregate by a second and a half.
Holy cow.
Holy cow.
Jake and the kids went with me over the whole 4th of July run, and it was pretty successful. I think I won about 15,000 over the 4th. So from that point forward, that's kind of as a family, we're like, okay, I'm going to rodeo and try to make the finals. So it really was probably the 4th of July weekend when we decided no more just, you know, there and backs. Like, if you need to be gone for a week, you can be gone for a week. And it was great because the kids did get to go with me a lot. So come the end of the year, there were 7 rodeos and I placed at every single one but Stephenville, and I won Poway. Like, it just, everything rolled. And like, when you get that ball rolling, how much easier it is to keep it going.
We were definitely tracking through all the rodeos. My dad, he was doing a lot of math with, like, right after they got the result, he was adding up all the money, making sure she still stayed in the bubble.
Every couple hours, it seemed like those last few rodeos, they couldn't post the results fast enough to see, you know, where she was at. But fortunately, she won enough. We knew she was pretty darn safe. So,
Definitely nerve-wracking, but awesome when we knew she was gonna make it.
San Bernardino, when I won second there, that was the last perf of that rodeo. I knew at that point I had just won Poway also. I remember walking out to the trailer and trying to unsaddle and just so full of emotion. And there were quite a few people all around the trailer, you know, and I did not want anybody to see me just like bawling. So before I think I even had him unsaddled, I walked into the living quarters and shut the door and called Jake and was just, I remember just crying.
She called me and she was, you know, pretty emotional, understandably, you know. I was pretty excited and it was a definitely happy moment. I wish I could have been there, but.
Getting ready for the NFR, I ended up going down a couple days earlier than Jake and the kids. So I went down by myself, got my pins situated, got all of our gobs of clothes moved up to the hotel, and all of that. The kids had, they had one more basketball game. So they stayed and went to their last basketball game, and then they all came down. And Jake, he was roping at the World Series, so he also had his rope horses that he had to bring down later. But as far as when it all hit, that first day that you have to go check in, like where the contestant parking is, and you get your parking passes and you get all your wristbands for your help, you know, for Jake to be able to be back there. And I remember just walking down that alley, and they're, you know, they're still taping up signs and setting stuff up kind of in the arena. But man, it's all set up. I mean, like, from what you visualize, I mean, it's got all the yellow walls and it, like, it's all set up. And that was the first, and I was completely alone for whatever reason. There was no one in there, no one. And this is, I mean, it was like probably 11 o'clock in the morning. It wasn't like super early or super late or anything, but I just remember, like, I got to take it all in all by myself. And it was, I don't know, it was a cool feeling.
My mom was very on the encouraging side, like, good job on this, work on this, and Dad does it too, but he also focuses on get this done. Get this done.
Pretty loose reins. Trot him on up there. Trot him right up there. Come on. Now go stop him. Come on, go stop him. Hurry. Atta girl.
Mom, she's always like telling us to relax and just do it, and Dad's helping us to make sure we don't just go like embarrass ourselves like horribly.
Go. Atta girl. So now you got time to get a good swing over him. There you go. Good job. Much better, huh? But see how that time you had time to get a look at him and went right around the horns, huh?
It really opens you up to a lot more horsemanship, and like riding my show horse, it taught me more to ride my barrel horse, like getting him to stand up more. And then same goes for team roping. I mean, you learn a lot from all three, and it affects everything else. And so I'm very blessed to be able to know all three and to learn from all three.
I like the aspect of being able to do both, because then like there's people that like that rodeo that can't even get their horse in the gates without like wrecking and stuff. And then so at our last rodeo, my super young one that we've only barrel raced on, since Dad like helped train her and like got her to be super broke and stuff, like she literally trotted up the alley and I had to like kick her to get her to go out the gate. We've never been to NFR in person before, so it was kind of cool when our parents told us that we would get to go for all 10 days.
Yeah, we watch it every year. Our family kind of places bets every year. It's definitely fun, but it's nothing like in person. In person, it's amazing.
So as far as the whole entire Vegas experience, from the back number ceremony to the last night, it was phenomenal. Like, I don't have a bad word to say about any of it. I had a lot of great advice going into it. So the fourth round, probably the best day of the whole 10 days. I got to go and watch Jake. He won like 35,000 in one of the ropings over there at the South Point.
Now, Matt on the headside said he is a husband to a barrel racer. One of his in front of barrels in the NFR. Now, his chance to win a little money here. He got a smooth run.
He was super happy, and then that night, I won the round that night. It was a crazy good day. Like over 60,000 in one day of both of us doing something we absolutely love. Then we had the buckle ceremony that night. We'd both been drinking for quite a while, so the buckle ceremony was very funny. But it was a great time. You know, we had so many friends down there throughout the whole time, that such positive vibes from everyone that it was impossible not to enjoy it or not to have a good time. And there's so much to be said about all of the preparation that you put into making these lifetime goals happen. I'm like I said, I'm a believer in enjoying the moment and enjoying what life has to throw at you, whether it's, you know, there's always gonna be, there's so many hard times in our lives that, by God, enjoy the good ones. Like, make the best of it. Right. Even if my horses don't like this arena, you know, cause that's another thing. I know I have two great horses, but that doesn't, you know, there's a lot of great horses that go to Vegas and they don't like that arena. And I had no idea whether mine were gonna be successful in it or not. I mean, you want to hope for the best, but I wasn't, 100% was not going to allow that to take the experience away from myself or my kids or my husband, all which have sacrificed and put so much into making this goal happen. The biggest thing that I hope that our girls can take away from watching Jake and I's success through all of this, but is being able to do what they love and find someone that supports them for what their passion is, what they love, and also to be able to give that in return, to learn that there's, it doesn't always have to be one-sided, to, you know, try to find a great balance of who they are and don't lose that, but also support someone that has the same passions in life.
She's a blue jean baby with her hat down low, chasing that wild wind wherever it blows, flying through the night just as fast as she can go. Yeah, it's one.